Thank you, Jim. I'm going to not talk about myself because there's a lot to cover here. First of all, I want to kind of appeal to the students from the New York and New Jersey area. We're going to have a major conference in New York on May the 12th. There's a flyer in your packet, which is going to bring together not only Noam Chomsky and Dan Ellsberg, but leading nuclear disarmament figures from Japan, from Europe, former UN High Representative for Nuclear Disarmament, and only 250 seats in the hall. So if you want to go, I wanted to make that announcement. The second thing I want to do is I want to make a couple comments on what was said before. First of all, to say that unfortunately there has been a role for nuclear weapons. As Dan Ellsberg, who basically wrote the U.S. nuclear warfighting doctrine at age 30, tells us, the United States has repeatedly, during international crises and wars, used its nuclear weapons in the same way that an armed robber uses his gun. Whether or not the trigger is pulled, the gun has been used. And the reality is that on more than 30 occasions, the United States has prepared or threatened to initiate nuclear war. We not only the Cuban Missile Crisis, but in relationship to North Korea about 9 times, and we came almost as close to nuclear war in 1976 over an incident that began with the chopping down of a tree as we did in the Cuban Missile Crisis. So this is a kind of history that we need to know and to understand. Nuclear weapons have been essentially the ultimate enforcers of empire. There's a reason why Trump has said that he's basically threatened to annihilate North Korea. The other point I want to make in terms of cost of war is to say there are many victims of nuclear weapons, not only in Japan where there were Japanese and Korean hibakusha, even here in the United States, people working in the nuclear assembly plants, downwinders from the tests, and U.S. military soldiers and sailors who were basically marched in and used as guinea pigs. So the numbers are as high as about 1 million people here in the United States who have suffered from illness and death. Later you'll be hearing about the Ban Treaty, and one of the key ways in which that was won was through the testimonies of these nuclear weapons victims, including a woman from St. George, Utah. I could go on, but I don't have time to do that. So I've been asked to talk about several treaties and to try to squeeze in a few words about Iran as well. So first to say that we have a long history of arms control agreements. No negotiations going on right now, but a long history. I had a list of about 10 that I won't go into now, but I want to focus on a couple. One of the seminal treaties of the 20th century, one of the three most important, was the Nuclear Non-proliferation Treaty. Negotiations began in 1968 and went into force in 1970. We tend to think of this as focused only on preventing other countries from developing nuclear weapons. But the reality is this was a fundamental deal between the nuclear weapons states and the non-nuclear weapons states. It was hard fought. And there are three pillars to this treaty. One is that the non-nuclear weapons states will not get nuclear weapons. And in exchange, they got two things. In Article 6, the nuclear powers, the P5, committed to good faith negotiations to completely eliminate their nuclear arsenals, right? And the other, which is a deep flaw in the treaty, is it gave the non-nuclear weapon states the rights to nuclear power generation for ostensibly peaceful purposes. I can go a lot into it, but now we're how many decades into the treaty, and what you find is that the nuclear powers have really resisted implementation of that. The Obama administration sabotaged the last review conference in 2015, basically to protect Israel and its nuclear arsenal. And as a result, this treaty is in jeopardy. And we have the other dynamics. One of the pieces I wanted to quote, there was reference in Aaron's talk to the founders, the initial physicists of the nuclear weapons age. One of them was Joseph Rotblat. Rotblat was the only senior scientist of the Manhattan Project to quit over for moral considerations. And he said later in his life, got a Nobel Peace Prize along the way, he said, look, the human species faces an absolutely stark choice. We can either completely eliminate the world's nuclear arsenals or we'll see their global proliferation. Why, he said? Well, because no nation will long tolerate what it perceives to be an unjust imbalance of power, or in this case, terror. So you have, you know, why the Chinese have their weapons? Because the United States and Russia. Why does Pakistan have it? Because of India. Why does India have it? Because of China. Why does North Korea have it? Because of the United States. We get to the Iran Treaty, and the reality is that if Trump and Bolton blow that treaty, then we're likely to see Saudi Arabia also joining the nuclear club. And, of course, the nuclear wars will follow this. The second one, real quickly, there was reference made earlier today to the New START Treaty. Clearly, there was the devil's bargain in it. Its value, at least the goal that, in negotiating it, was less the small reduction of the weapons, but more to maintain continued intrusive inspections on both sides, to maintain at least some level of strategic trust. So we knew what the Russians were doing. The Russians know what we're doing, right? And it was one at ridiculous cost in terms of the escalation of our nuclear weapons program. The reality is that that treaty is due to expire in 2021. There are no negotiations going on now between the United States and Russia. We've moved into basically a new Cold War environment with Russia. We are in a new arms race with Russia and the rest of the world. And if that treaty goes, you lose one of the elements needed to keep things under some control. I wanted to make a brief reference to the Intermediate Nuclear Weapons Forces Treaty. Basically, this was negotiated in 1987. It marks the end of the Cold War before the collapse of the Berlin Wall. It was won largely through the nuclear weapons freeze movement here in the United States, allied movements in Europe, and the brilliant leadership of Mikhail Gorbachev. Basically, it bans both the United States, or NATO, and Russia from having intermediate missiles with a range of 300 to 3,500 miles, basically to end the preparations for the destruction of Europe as part of the great powers confrontation. We see a similar kind of thing going on now with Korea. And what we see is that it seems from both sides we're moving into violations of that treaty. I've been to Hiroshima maybe about 25 times in my lifetime. We need to understand the reality of what nuclear weapons would do, what a single nuclear weapon would do, what a small exchange, 50 to 100 will bring on global cooling, the deaths of up to 2 billion people, right? So we need to understand this stuff is very real and very urgent, and the dangers are great. There was the reference earlier this morning to command and control, the whole history of nuclear weapons accidents. In fact, we managed to keep Boston from being turned into a nuclear weapons base under Senator Kennedy and Reagan and by bringing the former operations officer of the Third Fleet up to testify in city council about the Navy's history of nuclear weapons accidents, some of which he had witnessed. So with the time I have remaining, I want to say a little bit more about the Iran deal. We're largely focused on the crisis with Korea with good cause. It's as frightening as it appears to be. Victor Cha was speaking at Harvard earlier this week telling us that the no strategic thinking going on in the White House and that the administration is just as chaotic and undisciplined as it appears to be from the outside. Let's get the right page here. Simply to say that this was the high point of Obama's international diplomacy. It's not clear that Iran was seeking to develop a nuclear weapon, but certainly the potential to build it in the future. In the deal, the Iranians gave away 98% of their enriched uranium. It was basically the Russians took care of that. They destroyed 13,000 of their 19,000 centrifuges. They committed to incapacitate their heavy water reactor, which is needed to make weapons-grade plutonium. And the International Atomic Energy Agency was mandated to do very, very intrusive inspections. And as we know, IAEA, all of our partners, time's up, I'm moving toward the end, all committed, all said that, you know, the treaty is being implemented. There's no question about it being implemented. But you have Trump, who has said this is, you know, the worst treaty ever negotiated. Bolton and Pompeo. I mean, Pompeo, when he was in Congress, opposed it. The reality is that if this is breached, and Trump may refuse to certify it on May the 12th, if it's breached, on the one hand, that undermines any ability to negotiate something with North Korea. Why should they trust an agreement with the United States if we're violating with Iran? On the other hand, it also undercuts any trust, any respect that basically any nation in the world will have with the United States. I mean, our European allies, Japan, others, I mean, why would they trust a country that makes agreements and then just violates them? No respect for those international laws. So if you look at the decline of U.S. power and influence, the disrespect that the rest of the world has for us, look at that possibility. Of course, it could also mean that Iran moves toward the development of nuclear weapons. And as I said before, the Saudis are already saying, you know, if Iran moves further toward going nuclear, then we're going to have a Saudi bomb as well. So the stakes are extremely high. And I guess just my last plea is to say, just to talk about biology. A lot of us with white hair are not going to be here a lot longer. It's assuming we don't have a war with North Korea. And if there's going to be, it's just the obvious piece, but just to say it, I mean, I remember feeling patronized when I was a student and people saying it. But simply to say, you know, the world is going to be what you're going to make it. I mean, that is a really basic truth. And you don't want to waste any time doing it. Thank you.